Welcome to WMVG, the weekly Multivarious Games podcast. It's episode 70.
Yay! If we would be in disco land.
The septadecennial.
If this was the 1900s.
Yeah.
Ye old 1900s.
Welcome to the 1900s podcast. This year, can we do that? Let's just make a podcast where we talk about each year.
I'm sure there's got to be one that already exists.
There should be a history podcast.
I'm sure they exist.
Yeah. I would be willing to put down $2 that there is a history podcast.
I have a single dollar in my wallet. Let's do this thing.
But I'm
like
Chris.
they theme
it's
every
Cody.
Episode. Hi.
It's Will.
Hi.
They theme every episode.
I'm sure that exists.
I
would not be surprised if that didn't exist.
It does now.
More spacious.
You can have that
couch.
One, Internet.
That one's on you, Internet. Housekeeping.
Let's do it.
Do we have housekeeping?
We're doing Global Game Jam.
Global Game Jam this weekend.
By the time they hear this, we'll be sold out of. Well, we're already sold out of tickets.
Yeah.
So
we sold out of Global Game Jam tickets. So that'll be fun.
Yeah. So we're hosting Global Game Jam at our place.
Yeah.
Which will be fun.
Cog Jam.
Yeah. I'm excited to see what people come up with.
Yeah.
It's always interesting. Just have a bunch of people that don't get to make games most of the time together.
Making games.
Yeah. Maybe we could actually sit down and finish that frigging game we started last year.
Maybe. I wasn't planning on showing up, but if you want to, I'll maybe stop by on Sunday.
No, I'm going to be showing up intermittently, but maybe I'll make that like a personal thing to kind of revisit that.
Yeah, I really want to dive back into that. We had a thing going there.
We did.
You guys should
explain what happened to us, Chris.
I don't know, but we should hug.
We should hug.
We've known each other for a year now.
Yes, we have. It's been a whole year.
It has been.
So I feel special.
That's exciting.
You guys should explain what game you're talking about.
We made a card game.
Haven't we talked about it before?
Yeah, I think we've talked about it. So it was a card game with like this horror theme where you and four others had to sort of escape this house while simultaneously not screwing each other over.
Yep.
And we worked on it. We got some good stuff. And then I showed it to a publisher who kind of liked it, and they gave some suggestions. And there's just some like, there's like a couple fundamental things we could just never figure out to like really make it tight.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it was more of a lack of just spending the time to do it.
Yeah, I have full confidence that we could actually work through those issues, but we just got to work on it.
But it's a pretty cool game, and it play tested pretty well.
Yeah,
yeah.
People seem to enjoy it.
But that was the first time Will and I ever really talked. You just showed up.
Yeah, I just showed up on Sunday.
And I wasn't working on a team, and I was just like, hey, I got this kind of idea. You want to fool around with it for a bit?
Well, yeah, sure.
That was fun.
So wait, that was your first time doing anything W or MVG wise?
I mean, I had showed up like sporadically a little bit, but like that was the first time I actually sat down with somebody on the team and like worked through something.
I was gonna say, I thought I knew you before then, but like vaguely.
There was very little time before that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it was cool. And so hopefully like, I mean, that's the neat thing is you get like little sprinklings of ideas on these games. You only have 48 hours. So it's like, most of the time, you're not going to make something that's even close to a finalized project.
Yeah. I mean, do we have to talk about Big Stupid Murder from last year?
But, you know, you sometimes get a little sprout and you spend a little time working on it.
Yeah.
It can turn into a real thing. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Housekeeping.
Housekeeping. Old game jam.
We got Patreon. Give us money. There's nothing on it. And we haven't updated it like ever.
Yeah, we made it like a year
ago. I don't even know if you can find it.
There you go.
Is it patreon.com/multivarious maybe?
I don't know. I'm going to blur that out though. But if you can find our Patreon, shoot us an email with a picture that you found our Patreon. And I will give you a virtual high five.
High five.
Yeah. Speaking of emails, we got some listener email last week.
Are we jumping straight into a listener email?
We're jumping straight into a listener email.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to strap in here.
Oh, yeah. Strap in here. Yeah, no. So actually, it was like an hour after we recorded last week's email. Or last week's podcast.
The one that we didn't have an agenda for and kind of just shit our way through for an hour.
Yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, I haven't gotten, I'm only like 5 minutes into that and I can already tell.
It wasn't our best performance.
You know, the middle was good. The middle was good of last podcast. It was just the beginning that was pretty off to a
rocket. That's why structure is good.
Yes. Yeah, we didn't have enough time to structure because we're so busy here. I couldn't do it. Anyway, listener mail.
Yes.
From my friend Robert.
Hi, Robert.
Oh, hey, Robert. Hi. Hello to the wonderful people at Multivarious Games.
We just saw him yesterday.
Yeah. I've been thinking about this, and I'm wondering if I could get your input. Back in the day, it was video game companies that made video game consoles. Nintendo, Atari, Sega. But now, two out of the three companies making consoles, Sony and Microsoft, are not video game companies. Sony makes hardware and the majority of the software produced by Microsoft are business tools. Is this normal for the video game market, or is this just a fad in the industry and eventually video game companies will go back to making video game consoles? I'd like to hear your input. Your fan, Robert.
What about Sony Computer Entertainment?
Thanks, Robert. So I think first off, people who made Sony is a software developer.
Yeah.
Like they own, what, I think 22 studios worldwide?
They have quite a few. So yeah, that's. I think the idea there is like, you know, Sonic was made by Sega, whereas you know, now we know the developers. So it's Sonic is made by Sonic Team, where you know Uncharted is made by Naughty Dog, whereas you know,
which is still a Sony team.
Though. Yeah, which is still a Sony team. So I think maybe there's just a maybe it's just the way how the industry has kind of grown into looking more towards developers that we've looked away from the fact that like Sony owns places, Microsoft owns 343, like Microsoft owns Rare, like.
Yeah. They did own Bungie, yeah.
Yeah, so
they own Mojang now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Which so I found out recently it's pronounced Mojang, not Mojang.
Yeah, it's a soft yay.
It's a Swedish company. I guess that makes sense.
I
think also a couple things. I mean, there's always been third-party developers, more or less.
Yes.
Yeah.
At least if you're talking about like the NES on, which is kind of the birth of
the console.
Current console
thing.
So one of the things that, you know, sometimes people don't realize is like Nintendo had a lot of third parties. So you have, you know, Capcom and Konami and a whole Hudson Soft and a whole bunch of other ones.
Oh yeah.
But Nintendo was like vicious at locking third party developers into exclusivity contracts. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, even though Nintendo might not have owned that studio, I mean, for all intents and purposes, they did, because they were like, you're making a game for us.
It was the golden handcuffs, basically.
Yeah,
so.
this is when it's going to come out, you know, because they controlled the manufacturing process as well for the cartridges. So they pretty much were able to kind of dictate timelines for stuff.
Yeah.
And they were like, while you're making this game, you are not working with anybody else. And that's changed. So it might be more a reflection of just how many studios there are now that it seems by comparison, the internal studios are less. But I mean, Nintendo's still, you know, they do their thing.
Their games. Yeah, Nintendo's definitely the exception because Nintendo has their like teams. But again, you know, I think like Nintendo develops games, but if you think about it, it's no different than Naughty Dog developing for Sony. It's just Naughty Dog has a name instead of just going by Nintendo or instead of going by Sony. So.
Yeah.
Maybe it's the difference of Microsoft and PlayStation are more willing to buy studios to create games for them in place of Nintendo, where they kind of...
Well, they still have their internal teams. Yeah. And, like, there's, like, the Zelda team and the Mario team or whatever, and, like, Miyamoto's on...
Yeah, totally.
Bouncing between different projects.
Yep.
But typically you don't hear...
Maybe it's just the Miyamoto team. They all bow to his will.
Yeah. But yeah, typically you don't hear of like, you know, Nintendo, like Nintendo, if Nintendo were to buy Platinum, let's say, because they got the exclusive with
Bayonetta,
like hypothetically in a world where Nintendo would buy Platinum, do you think they would stay as Platinum or they would just get absolved into the Nintendo and become like the Platinum team?
I don't know.
I'm just...
I could see Nintendo just absorbing everything into the Nintendo brand.
Yeah. Like, I could see that, so I guess it's just a brand control.
Yeah, the reality of the market these days is that Sony and Microsoft need to get third-party developers on their console as a minimum, just as a bare, and then they're fighting for exclusivity. So with so many indie developers around now, one of the goals is just get those games onto your platform. And Nintendo's done a few things like Shovel Knight and stuff, but Bayonetta, you just mentioned.
Yeah.
But by and large, like, you know, I don't know who does more, Sony or Microsoft. I mean, Sony's in the lead for sure in terms of acquiring indie exclusivity.
Of course.
But I don't know. Between Microsoft and Nintendo, I don't know which one. Microsoft probably?
Who has the bigger AAA dev lab?
No. Who is attracting more indie devs to their system?
I would say Microsoft.
Sony. Really?
I mean, Sony's number one.
So we're fighting for a second.
By a huge margin.
Who's the next one? Definitely Microsoft.
I'd say Microsoft. Because, you see... Well, you know...
I mean, you want to say that, But I keep saying Sony.
Yeah. Does Microsoft PC count at all in this? Because PC beats all of them.
Well, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but that's the thing. It's like PC is a platform, really.
Yeah.
I mean, you can make the argument that Sony and Microsoft, Xbox and PlayStation are platforms, but Microsoft just makes the OS and then people build on that. So, mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know,
so why do I keep saying freaking Sony? Microsoft doesn't need to go out and attract people for PC development.
That's true.
That's just, yeah. They just do it.
So, when you think about it, technically, Microsoft owns Windows. People develop indie games for Windows.
Yeah. I mean, if you consider Windows to be
part of
what we're talking
then
about,
Microsoft smokes everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think generally, like Xbox versus PlayStation. But mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I was thinking about it, and like if you look at people in our scene, right, like the small indie scene, I know a lot more Wii U developers than I know Xbox One developers.
I know, it's the weird thing.
And yeah,
there's a fair number of Wii U developers that come to the expo.
Yeah.
And I don't think we've met one Xbox One developer. Did anyone at this year's expo make an Xbox One game? I don't think so. And I mean, I've said this before on previous podcasts, but I've pretty much given up trying to develop for Xbox One.
Yeah.
I'm just, mm-hmm. The effort I have put in to just trying to get stuff, and they're like, have you read the blog post? Have you filled out your indie whatever? I was just like, I don't want to have to read a blog post. Like, why can't you just talk to me like a normal person?
Yeah.
Like, I say this all the time, but when we started going through the process with Sony, outside of the static IP issue that you have to have, which is more a Time Warner thing than a Sony thing, you know, we were able to talk with them, get connected to who we want to. We had a phone call with one of the reps before we even filled out the application. Mm-hmm. We filled out the application within like a week. We were registered developers, and they sent us an email with like, here's your marketing person, here's your PR person, here's your quality assurance person, here's your project management person. Like, we have emails for all of the people that we need to connect to for anything. I still cannot even get like a straight answer from Microsoft.
Yeah, like what, we've met one person who was somewhat affiliated with Xbox in all of our communications.
Yeah, I mean, we had one conversation sort of in a roundabout way, and his solution was, you know, like, oh, I mean, we're still figuring some things out. You know, keep your eyes on the blog. I'm like, I'm not keeping my eyes on the blog.
Yeah.
Dude, I'm so busy. I don't have time to...
I don't care that much.
Yeah, I'm not going to be checking up on a blog. Like,
whatever. We're a bunch of PlayStation fanboys anyway. So.
That's true.
Well, I mean, like, I don't want to say I'm easily swayed, but I work very... I mean, you guys know this about me. Like, if you're a good partner with me, mm-hmm. and I trust you and I like you, like, I'll go to the mat for you. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing with, like, all of our... There's a reason why virtually every part of the expo is heavily discounted and they're sponsored by the people we work with. It's because when I talk with them and we talk about, you know, the exciting things we're doing, I'm looking for a partner. And so I come back to them again next year and the year after that, like our pipe and drape, our, you know, some of our audiovisual stuff, our photographer, the lanyards and the badges, like every little bit of that, I keep coming back to the same people every year because they're awesome to work with. Mm-hmm. Like if they were difficult to work with or a pain in the ass, I'd just go somewhere else.
Yeah, you would have dropped them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So thanks, anyway. Robert.
Yeah, thanks. Good question. For the question. We went on crazy side tangents.
I hope we interpreted it correctly.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think to loop it all back around, like, I don't think we're going to see Sega make another console. I don't think we're going to see Atari make another console. I think that we are probably going to see one less console in two generations. Yeah. I could very well see probably Nintendo dropping out of the race.
I can agree with that. I think Microsoft is too stubborn to drop out.
Yeah.
But, yeah, yeah. I mean, and the thing is, they're making money.
Yeah.
So it's like, if you don't really care about being the world's number one console or whatever, like, Microsoft's making a shit ton of money on the Xbox brand.
Yeah.
So, like, we have this thing where it's like, Apple just recently had their most successful quarter ever, which also happened to be the most successful quarter of any corporation in the world in the history of humanity.
Jeez.
And, you know, we have this tendency to kind of look at that and be like, wow, they're just like kicking ass and everybody else is garbage. But there's plenty of companies that are making billions and tens of billions of dollars.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, they're doing just fine. So if you don't mind being... The problem with the Wii U is it's not making money and it's I think it finally just broke even maybe halfway through last year or something.
I don't even know.
So, but yeah, if you don't mind like being second and still raking in a couple billion dollars a year,
yeah,
that's fine. Like I'll be second rate.
Yeah, I mean we've got a Wii U right underneath our recording right now.
Yep,
it's right there.
We use it all the time.
Totally.
We played Smash Bros. Once.
That's really all we do.
Smash
on it.
I just Tom holds me at knife point until I bring him my PS4 so we can play his Rock Band. And that's what happens here.
And don't forget too that the Wii U is like I think still the number one selling console like ever. Or not the Wii U, the Wii.
Yeah.
So I mean Nintendo was like, you know, it was like Nintendo, Super Nintendo, and it started like dipping.
Is it the PlayStation?
PS2 I think is second.
Okay.
Yep.
But I could be wrong. That may have flipped. But, you know, it's the Wii U did really, really good.
Yeah.
Well, let's see here. PlayStation 2.
There we go.
PlayStation 2 is actually the highest selling console.
So the PlayStation 2 is
Wii
over
is
155.
The fifth.
Oh, wow. I didn't realize the PlayStation 1 jumped ahead. Yeah, I'm counting consoles, not handhelds.
Yeah, so right. The top five of consoles and handhelds are PlayStation 2 with 155 million, Nintendo DS for 154, the original Game Boy for 118, PlayStation for 102 million, and then the Wii of just shy under 101.6.
I feel like that's real low.
Wow,
for the Wii,
N64 is all the way down there. That's
that's
surprising. I thought it did well.
The GameCube and the N64 did not do as well. I mean, what is that? N64, 32 million. The PS4 is already at. Is the PS4 on there? The PS4 is already at 35.9 million. So it looks like it's. I mean, it's broken the top five already of consoles. It looks like.
Yeah.
Not counting handhelds.
Hmm.
Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's number 6 right now.
The Sega Master System has outsold the Wii U at this point.
Or no, it's number 7, sorry.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Wii U, 10.73 million. That's just not very good.
That's not great.
Yeah.
But Xbox One's below that. So.
Yeah. But I mean, scroll back up again real fast.
Poor Vita.
So if you look at the top 10, Nintendo DS, Game Boy, Wii, and Game Boy Advance and Nintendo Entertainment System are like, so you have 5 of the top 10 best-selling devices are Nintendo.
Yeah.
So they have shown that, I mean, they got a history of making
shit work.
They
know their hardware,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, I mean, Nintendo has
Except the Wii U.
Yeah.
Yeah, Nintendo has the mobile market. Like
the only Microsoft thing is up there is the 360.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
4 of the top 10 are Sony's. 1 is Microsoft's, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are Nintendo, and just shy of the top 10 is the 3DS.
Wow, the PSP outsold the Game Boy Advance.
That's really surprising.
That is really surprising.
So let's go ahead and use some of our brand new crazy editing magic.
And there's the list!
Look at that!
System crash.
System crashes.
Everything dies. Well, we tried. But yeah, look at that.
So yeah, there's your list.
Can you just highlight, like jump down 15 and just highlight it so we know where we are.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15.
Sega Genesis.
15 is the Sega Genesis.
So.
Whoa!
Well, there's the top 15.
Here we go.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of the 15 are Nintendo systems.
Wow.
Yeah. One of those is a Sega.
Five are Sony,
and one is Microsoft.
And one is Sega.
Hell yeah!
So yeah, if you're just looking pound for pound, where's the original Xbox?
Right there.
Okay, so that's
17.
There we go.
Slightly. So the PS4 is past the Xbox. The Xbox One's somewhere.
Wow, the Wii U has sold half as much as the GameCube. And the GameCube was like denoted as a failure at the time, wasn't it?
I wonder where the Dreamcast is.
Dreamcast is one above
above the Vita.
Vita!
It's trying.
I don't care. I am 1/1,000,000th of these sales numbers.
Yeah.
And that makes me feel awesome and terrible all at the same time.
You tell. Go down. Where's the Coleco? Oh, there it is. ColecoVision.
Woo.
Below the N-Gage.
The Wonder Swan. I remember that.
Oh, man.
But yeah, you never know. Nintendo's NX thing could be real cool, or it could be really...
I'm still interested in what the hell that even is. But
yeah. Well,
yeah.
We'll see if his prediction comes true.
Didn't they say it was going to use an Android operating system or something like that?
And they said something about it working with your... They said something about it working with the PlayStation 4.
Yeah.
Like, there was something... I think they might be going, like, the Xbox route, where you can plug other consoles into it.
So it has an HDMI out.
I'm guessing it has an HDMI in. is going to be that's my what guess. I meant.
Would you like to buy the new console that's really just everybody else's console?
Yeah. Well, I'm wondering because, you know, they keep on saying...
It's finally happened. We have the game sphere.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what if that's their thing is they are looking at just emulating the PS4 and Xbox One and just having it be an all-in-one machine?
Hmm. That'd be insane.
I have no idea how they're going to survive the lawsuits from that, but...
Yep. It's like, yeah, whatever.
But it could be cool.
We're making millions of dollars. What else? Get out of here.
Sweet.
But yeah. So
we made your childhood. We can do anything.
We can do anything we want. Sweet. Well, while we're on the Nintendo train, let's talk about a new game that was announced for the 3DS.
If there's one thing I like, it's Japanese writing.
It's Japanese writing. You don't need to see much of the writing. So this is announced. It's coming out next week in Japan.
Next week?
Next week in Japan.
Okay. I mean, this is the first I've heard of it.
Is this a Harry Potter spinoff?
No. This is a Detective Pikachu.
It's even got, like, the Sherlock Holmes music.
Yeah.
Does Pikachu talk?
Pikachu is talking in a very gruff Japanese
detective
voice.
Wait, that's Pikachu's voice?
Yeah. That's Pikachu's voice.
What?
He's had a hard life, man.
Clearly.
All right. This is...
Look at that. He got the girl. He's going through London. Don't know what that says, but... There we go. So, roughly...
That's a 3DS game.
Yeah, so it's a 3DS game. I'm not really sure what it's about.
It comes out next week?
The game.
I wonder
if
it's like a Professor Layton type thing. Like,
I think
mostly a puzzle solver.
I think it is. It looks like a cinematic kind of... More of a cinematic game over a... gameplay game, because there's no way that this is all like that's their gameplay that they've shown in the trailer.
Okay,
man, I would kill for LA Noire, but it was just all a
Pokemon
detective game. Like, if you just took LA Noire and carved out all the driving bullshit and the fighting bullshit, and it was just all a detective game,
like, I agree with you on that.
Like, that would be really neat.
The detective aspects of that game were really interesting.
I actually never played LA Noire, which is sad.
It's cool,
it's a pretty cool game.
I had never finished it.
I did.
I always liked Rockstar's other non-GTA games, with the exception of Rockstar Table Tennis.
Red Dead Redemption is easily one of my favorite games of all time.
Red Dead Redemption's great.
Everybody's all about it. I never finished it. Like, I got into it for a bit, and then
I
got distracted. I liked it, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But I just didn't get a chance. And I know the ending-ish.
Yeah. I never finished it either, but I remember... So growing up, I loved Red Dead Revolver. Which
didn't play a whole lot of that one.
I don't believe Red Dead Revolver was a Rockstar game.
Was it not?
I don't think so. But I played a lot of Red Dead Revolver as a kid, which is more... So that game wasn't open. It was a more linear...
Yeah.
Rockstar San Diego.
Rockstar San Diego.
Son of a bitch. All right.
Oh, yeah. They were made by the...
But that wasn't an open world game, right?
Yeah, it was
like Red Dead Redemption. It was like an action shooter.
Yeah, it was an action shooter. It was linear. But my friend Ronnie and I used to just play the multiplayer constantly. Like, that was the best part of the game. But yeah, so we always wished for a sequel to Red Dead Revolver. So then I remember I think it was at E3, they announced Red Dead Redemption, and I immediately texted him. I was like, did you just see that?
Dude!
It's like, it's open world! It's GTA with horses! This is the best! So him and I played quite a bit of that later.
Yeah.
A lot of nights playing poker.
Still hasn't come to PC.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's a surprising fact, right?
Wow.
Right? People have been clamoring for Red Dead Redemption on PC for years, and it still hasn't come out.
They could do like a shoddy port and still make tons of money off it.
I know. And I would buy it.
Rockstar, you've got like $60 right there. Right there.
I mean, for $60, you gotta do it, right?
Yeah. My approval means everything.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. But anyway, Detective Pikachu.
Sounds good.
It's going to be a game. It's going to be a thing.
Okay.
So, Will, you were talking about Life is Strange recently, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you digging that game? You finished it, right?
I finished it, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, recently, they just announced some concepts. So, I thought, since Will was talking about it earlier...
Wait, they announced concepts for a game that's already out?
It's just concept art.
They just released some concept
art. Like old concept art?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, there's just some old concept art. So, I just... So I haven't played it. Chris, have you played?
No. Is it on Vita?
No. It's on PS4.
Is it?
Yeah. It's a PS4 game.
Is that good?
I liked it.
Will?
I like I said on the last podcast, I don't think I can blanket recommend it to everybody. But if you're into, like, you know, these adventure style games or any Telltale games, which this one's probably worth your time.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm feeling. Well, I just got The Witness.
Yeah, so, I've been hearing a lot about that.
That's
a puzzle game, though, right?
It is a 40 to 100 hour puzzle game that's supposed to be like about the process of learning. It's pretty much everybody. I mean, it's getting awesome reviews.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And pretty much every review is like, we can't really tell you what it's about because otherwise it just completely kind of ruins the experience.
Huh. Well, now I'm interested.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Jonathan Blow. He made that
it
one.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah. He put all his Braid money.
Of Braid fame.
Into that.
And the game shows, that game is beautiful.
It looks, yeah. I've seen, of the screenshots that I've seen, it looks really good.
Yeah, there was a...
It looks really cool, I should say.
But. I have to recommend, there's a video out that's The Witness long screenshot, and it took forever to find that, but if you search on YouTube, you'll find it, and it's just like a pan of the entire island that the game is set on,
uh-huh.
and it's an awesome like trailer, just for like showing the visual, like from like a visual standpoint, it's a sweet trailer.
Did they market that game at all? Because this is...
The Witness? It was supposed to be a launch title.
Yeah.
Really?
It was at the PlayStation 4 reveal.
Because beginning of this week is the first time I ever heard of it.
Mm-hmm. They marketed it for a while, and I think, maybe Jonathan Blow's just like, let it do its thing.
Let it do its thing.
Yeah.
So...
Because Undertale kind of did that too. There was absolutely no marketing or very little marketing leading up to it. Mm-hmm. And then once it released, everybody started talking about the game.
Yeah. So
and it's also $40, which is...
The Witness?
Yeah.
Which so, wait for it to go on sale.
I broke down. I bought it yesterday. I haven't played it yet. But I mean, it's a 40 to 100 hour game.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's probably... I can't think of any other ones right now, but it's probably the most AAA of... indie games kind of made.
Hmm.
I'm sure there's other ones that, yeah, I don't know, Tacoma's maybe kind of a AAA-ish game.
Like Fulbright stuff.
Yeah.
Firewatch maybe.
I might need to start rationing my money depending on the games coming out this month.
Yeah.
There's The Witness, which sounds cool and I might pick up.
Well, I think it's a PS4 exclusive is the only issue.
It's on PC.
It's going to be on PC.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, cool. It's there. But XCOM 2 comes out next week.
Yeah.
And then Far Cry Primal also comes out in February.
Are you interested in that game?
Far Cry Primal?
Yeah.
I wasn't interested in Far Cry 4. I loved Far Cry 3.
Yeah.
And Far Cry Primal looks pretty cool, too.
Far Cry 4 was pretty cool.
Okay.
I enjoyed it. I mean,
it looked like Far Cry 3.
It's again. Far Cry 3.
Yeah, so.
Essentially, it's Far Cry 3, but with
Far Cry 3 with slightly less interesting characters.
Yeah, it's Far Cry 3 with, like more air vehicles.
Okay.
So, like, you have, like, your glide suit and your... There's like a helicopter and stuff, but it was cool. Do we want to go down? Chris, did you play Far Cry 3?
No. Okay. I haven't played any Far Cry.
Do you care? If Will and I discuss Far Cry 3 for a second?
No.
What did you think about Voss?
I loved Voss.
I was very disappointed with
I think he was really underutilized.
Yes. That's why I was disappointed.
But I loved his character.
Everybody talked about... So I guess that's the thing with Voss is that... You know, everybody talked about how good of a character he was and like, you know, oh, Voss is this great character and he's amazing and it's the best part of the whole game. And then stuff happens. I guess, spoiler warning, Voss dies halfway through the game.
Yeah.
And then you like face like generic mobster dude
yep.
for the rest of the game. And it's like, well, this game got a lot.
This got worse very quickly.
Yeah. Because I remember playing through it. Mm-hmm. All of my friends were just like, yeah, Voss is great. Voss is the best thing ever. I think he beat Handsome Jack for a villain of the year.
Wow.
Like that year. Which was bullshit, because Handsome Jack is an awesome villain.
Have you played Tales from the Borderlands yet?
It's on my list.
Play it!
I know! I want to.
Speaking of Handsome Jack.
Metal Gear. I need to beat Metal Gear. I need to beat Chrono Trigger. And then I'm switching to...
He does need to beat Chrono Trigger.
I'm switching to Tales from the Borderlands.
But you also have to play Chrono Trigger twice.
Why?
Because that's how that game functions.
No.
Okay.
That's how
I will do it as I do with every other game, and I will play a second... If I really, really enjoyed it, I'll play a second playthrough in a year after the novelty is worn off.
Oh, but that's the thing is, this: you're introduced to a whole bunch of new stuff. It's not like playing the game a second. It's not like doing Persona, where it's the same game, but like you're a little stronger. Like,
look, I don't know about you... But I was a doctor's assistant. I was a janitor my second playthrough that I never saw. I saw a completely different ending with a weather woman. That was interesting. Huh?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Exactly.
And now I'm very confused.
Persona.
Okay.
Anyway, let's move on. So yeah, Life is Strange. Do you recommend it? Are you still sticking
on it? He said he can't do a blanket recommendation.
It's not a blanket recommendation, but if you like point-and-clicky style adventure games, go for it.
If you like games and you're not a bitch, then yeah.
Then yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Also, the concept art looked cool and stuck pretty close to the final product.
So that's sweet. I always like them on concepts. It's always interesting to see concept of other games. Mm-hmm. Sony changed their name.
They did?
That's the thing that happened.
All right.
Everybody on the internet's complaining because Sony's allowed to change their name, but they won't let other people change their names on PSN.
Hmm. Oh.
The Sony atmosphere is weird.
Yeah.
But yeah, so they are now Sony Interactive Entertainment instead of Sony Computer. Sony Interactive Entertainment instead of Sony Computer Entertainment.
Sony Computer Entertainment.
Yeah.
Okay, so they are now SIE instead of SCE.
Yes.
Yes.
In part because of the PlayStation VR.
Yeah. Hmm. Wait, is it because of PlayStation VR?
Well, that's part of the interactive portion. They're just putting everything under one hood, even though it kind of was before, but
yeah,
that's where all the software, hardware, networking stuff will be now.
Yeah, that was kind of the interesting thing, because what was it? The other one was Sony. Is it merging with Sony Online Entertainment? Is that what the big...
I don't know. I would not be surprised if this was a precursor to Sony starting to sell off a few of its other divisions.
That isn't PlayStation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, they've already have with like a Vio. Sold off Vio. I'm sure Bravia.
I don't know if their TV business is doing well or not. I don't know, but
it's got that PS Now functionality that's now on like every other TV.
That's cool.
Yeah, I guess that's the thing.
I think it's been eclipsed. What's by a Samsung?
FNAF World.
Five Nights at Freddy's World.
Oh, is that the thing that was released and sucked?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There we go.
And then he took it down and was like, hey, I'm going to release it later.
Didn't he say he wasn't going to make any more Five Nights at Freddy's games? He's a liar.
But he said that after three and he made four. So
he says that every time. Whoa!
Whoa, this is an ad.
Whoa, ads. Yeah. So Five Nights at Freddy's World. It got pulled.
Yeah, because he released it. And then it was in this really, really sorry state, missing a lot of key features. And then he basically said, hey, I'm sorry, this game isn't up to my standards or yours. So he took it down, made everybody erase their accounts who already had the game and were enjoying it for like 9 hours. And he erased everything. And then he's like, I'll release it later in the
year. Wait, can you do that?
Apparently.
Interesting.
Like, whatever. Wipe.
He just wiped the slate completely clean.
Yeah, I know that he reached out to Steam, and he's just like, give everyone refunds.
Yeah.
And it was like, I don't
mandatory
care.
Refunds. Everybody had to have a refund on the game.
Yeah.
Because he took it down completely.
So he paid for that, I'm assuming?
Probably.
Yeah.
I'm sure Valve was like, yeah, we're not paying for that.
Yeah, we're not going to do that.
So the Five Nights at Freddy guy, Scott Cawthon?
Scott
Cawthon. He is currently in talks with Universal's for a movie deal.
Yep.
Just released like a book that I'm pretty sure became a bestseller, I think.
Apparently it was pretty decent.
Yeah, there was a pretty decent book about Five Nights at Freddy's. He has toy lines in Target now. Like, I walked into a Target and there's Five Nights at Freddy's plushies everywhere. He just announced a new toy line with Funko. Like, Scott's doing fine. He can take the hit on that one. But yeah, so it was just an interesting story how he's like mandated Valve, like, I'm taking it down, it didn't live up to my standards, I'm sorry. Even though he released it early, as he always does.
Yeah.
So I just think it's an interesting story more than anything. But
Sounds good.
Well, speaking of interesting stories, let's talk about Street Fighter V for a second.
Okay.
Are you guys excited about that at all?
Nah.
No. Chris, you used to like Street Fighter, didn't you?
Yeah, but I've moved on.
You're out of the...
I was thinking about it this morning, too. I think I've moved on from Fallout.
From Fallout?
Really?
I think if Fallout 5 comes out, I'm just going to be like, meh.
Not a fan of Fallout 4?
It was fine. It was pretty much exactly like Fallout 3. Mm-hmm. And just... at the end of the day, I kind of look back and I was like, I didn't leave that experience really with anything.
Fair enough.
You know, like The Witcher, I felt like I left with like a real good experience. Mm-hmm. But
and I can't wait to dive back in once all the DLC comes out.
Yeah, I mean, Bloodborne, like, I love that, that process, but it just Fallout was just like,
it's a game.
Yeah, yeah, that was
a really long game.
Yes,
that was the saddest thing I think about Fallout. Like, I was fully anticipating to just get blown away by it, and then I just found myself transferring over to like Just Cause, and I'm like, this game is so good.
I think that was everybody's reaction to Fallout 4. Like, it just wasn't as good as it should have been.
Is there a gas leak in this room? I mean, like, you know, natural gas, not passing gas.
Oh.
Well, if we blow up.
I did fart like 5 seconds ago.
Yeah. As I say, if we blow up, it's nice to know you. But... All right. Anyway, what are we doing here?
You are technically correct.
Yeah. So anyway, so with Street Fighter V, this guy went through and he modded in different. He took the different models and put the different.
Oh, God. Sizes on them.
Yeah.
And so you just get incredible monstrosities like this. So I just thought, you know, maybe we just sit here, just show it off for a quick second. Right, let's go ahead and cut to Will's face right now. That's pretty great.
Yeah.
Who is Vega supposed to be?
I don't know.
Rainbow Mika? I don't know what kind of character she
is. That's Vega with severe dwarfism.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, kind of. But,
yeah, that's definitely our Mika.
There's a really good scene here in a second. Hold on. Ah! There we go.
Oh, God.
That nice ass slap right there.
You know what? That is totally a Vega thing to do, though.
Yep. I just, well, there you go. That needs to become a move for Vega. But anyway. Yeah.
Jesus.
That was just, you know.
Dalsim has a beard now.
And that's why UVs and texturing are important.
Yeah. Jesus. And very, very fun to mess around with.
That was disturbing. Thank you, Cody.
Yeah, no problem. I just wanted to kind of show that out, show the audience, because it hit, I think it was pretty viral recently, and there we go.
I saw a glimpse of it on Kotaku while ago.
I like it. So, speaking of a glimpse of Kotaku, Mighty No. 9 got delayed again. Do you guys even care about this game anymore?
Not
Did you
really.
Ever care about this game?
I cared about it at one point, but then it took way too long until I heard anything about it, and now I don't care.
Yeah,
I enjoy Mega Man as much as the next guy, but like at this point, I'm just like, when it comes out,
when
I'll kind of give it a second look. But
if it's good, I'll probably buy it. Otherwise,
yeah.
Yeah.
And it's such a kind of entitled thing to be at, like where we are as gamers, where it's kind of like back when you were a kid, you'd be so excited about something because good games only came out like so often. Mm-hmm. Now it's just like, there's so much shit to play. I'm just like, whatever. It could be, this could be a 10 out of 10 masterpiece game. I'm like, ah, fuck it. I'll get around to it.
That's kind of how I feel with the Jonathan Blow's game, with The Witness.
Yeah.
Where, like, people are ranking it. It's going to be great. I want to play it, but I'm just like, I have so much other shit to play right now.
See, I loved Braid, and it's not that...
I still need to play Braid.
It's not that people are giving The Witness, like, really high scores. It's that, like, people are being like, this is sort of a redefinition of what it is to play a game. And, like...
Bless you.
Bless you. And that, that kind of stuff only comes around... You know, every so often.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like if it was a third person cover shooter game that was getting nines and tens, I'd be like, okay, but I've played that game before. But
right.
A lot of people are like, the Witness is like a whole other kind of experience.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's what excites
me. See, I'm almost the exact opposite in that I wait around for games like that.
Yeah.
Than I do just like, you know.
Yeah. It's not so much, it's the fact that
it's like only the 9 out of 10s and 10 out of 10s that I pay attention to anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like I want to play. More, I want to play The Witness at some point. So maybe I was phrasing it wrong and just saying like I'm blowing it off. Like I'm not gonna play.
Are
it
you
yet.
Blowing it off?
I'm not gonna play it yet, just because I have so many other games that I've already put money into that I feel I can wait on a $40 experience. You know what I mean? Like sure. I don't need to own that right now.
Fair enough.
I still have like just out of like the games that were getting relatively good reviews. Like I still have Fallout to play. I still have The Witcher to play. I still have Chrono Trigger to play. I still have Danganronpa to play. Like, I still have all these other games that I should be playing before I buy another one.
Yep.
Or else I'm just going to keep up in this cycle of buying games and then not playing them.
Yeah.
And I currently have... I open up all my games as soon as I get them. But if I didn't, I'm sure I'd have, like, 7 or 8 shrink-wrapped games on my shelf right now.
When you play Chrono Trigger, are you putting it with, like, headphones on?
No, I'm not.
You should be.
It's the music's super good.
Yeah, the music's amazing.
I'm digging it.
And the music, like, they use sounds and music in that game to like convey a lot of interactions between things. So I'd recommend playing it with headphones.
Well,
just saying.
Just saying.
I mean, at least you're playing with the music on, right?
Yeah.
But I don't think the 3DS speakers are going to kind of do it justice.
The 3DS speakers are good.
Yeah.
I mean, they're not great. It's not like playing it through a sound system, but right. I'm pretty sure it sounds...
You be you, man. I'm just... Those are my... That's my words.
I'm pretty sure my it words would sound of wisdom. Relatively close to what an SNES would be putting out. So, I don't know.
All right. What's up next?
Mighty Number 9. I was gonna say I was really looking forward to it. I love Inafune. I like Mega Man a lot. I forgot that I had it for a while actually. I pre-ordered the limited edition with like the little guy.
Yeah.
There's like a little figure. It was like $60 instead of like 30 or whatever. And it comes with a physical copy of the game and then a little figure of I don't even know his name right now.
Beck.
Yeah. And like I've almost canceled that game like 3 times now because I'm just like I don't know if I care enough, but it's a thing.
I wasn't gonna go for a second beer until you did it.
Icebreaker.
I'm still like halfway through my first. God. So Will, talk about what you wanted to add to the podcast today because I somehow missed it.
EA is not gonna be at E3 this year.
Yay!
Ding dong, the witch is dead.
Is that a good thing?
I think so.
I think it's a good thing. After they interviewed Pele for 15 minutes in the middle of an E3 presentation, it's a good thing.
Yeah, like that became the office joke for like what, a month?
I mean, I get that, but are they not going to be on the show floor or anything?
Yeah, apparently they canceled their presser, but they're doing this EA Play. It's kind of like Nintendo Direct. They're doing their own thing.
Yeah,
June 12th through the 14th or something like that.
Lame.
So,
E3, man, are they going to be hurting here?
No.
Because of EA leaving? I doubt it.
Well, I mean, you gotta keep E3 was almost dead for a little bit.
That's true.
And it had a resurgence. But, you know, if EA is a big... Nintendo's not there anymore. EA's not. If another big one, like, is not there,
mm-hmm.
that could be really bad for that conference.
So, for the pressers, we got... Ubisoft always has one.
Yeah.
Bethesda
had one last year because of Fallout.
Yeah, they're not going to have one this year.
They're not going to have one this
year. Sony, Microsoft, obviously. He's not going to be there. Is that it this year? It's just going to be Sony, Microsoft, and Ubisoft?
Square Enix typically does one.
Do they?
Yeah, they do it on the second day, though.
Oh, okay.
So typically on the first day, it is Sony, Microsoft, Ubisoft, and EA. And then on the second day, they do their PC one.
Mm-hmm.
They have like the PC showcase, and then they have Square Enix.
I see.
So, I mean, I'm sure the PC one is probably still going to stick around, especially with all this new stuff with, like, Oculus and such.
That's probably going to make a pretty big appearance at EA this year, or E3 this year.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things, like, when you think about it, like, the EA was just a collective groan for our entire office when we did the showing of it.
Yeah.
Where it's just, you know, I never look forward to EA because they get excited about, like, FIFA and Madden. And
fantasy football last year. What the hell?
Yeah.
The only thing more boring than Madden is fantasy football, and they've devoted like 10 minutes of it.
Yeah.
It shows how good this conference was, because I don't remember anything you guys were talking about.
And like they had the Plants vs. Zombie guy, who just like got shoot off a stage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, did they not? Some of those press conferences are so bad. That's what I miss about like.
I don't know why Ubisoft still has a presser. They are the embarrassments every year.
I think Ubisoft is much better. I get a lot more enjoyment out of Ubisoft than I did from like EA.
Yeah.
Like I know they, Aisha Tyler's questionable.
Yep.
As a host every year, but like, I don't know. You get to see the new Assassin's Creed was pretty cool this year. Mm. Like they unveiled the new South Park game, which fuck yes.
That's true.
I think they showed off The Division. What was their new one that they showed off?
Rainbow Six.
Yeah, the new Rainbow Six game looks really Siege. Good. Like, they always have, like, a decent surprise. You know, there's something to look forward to with an Ubisoft. Whereas EA, it's just like, I hear they're going to show Mass Effect for 50 seconds. Let's just keep on...
And it's a pre-rendered trailer, so it shows us nothing about gameplay.
Or like, the Star Wars Battlefront, where, like, they had to continuously put up, like, Star Wars Battlefront, 15 minutes, please don't go.
Like, that's the only reason we were even there.
Yeah, and they knew, so they put it at the end.
Yep.
But, yeah, yeah. I'm not... Whatever. That's one less conference that we have to watch.
Yeah.
Chris, you should be happy about this. It's one less conference that we have to show at the office.
Yay. Yeah. I like watching the conferences at the office.
Yeah, it's great.
I dream of the day when we can watch them and my heart doesn't dip a little bit because of all the productivity we're losing. It'll be a glorious day.
It'll never happen. But yeah, so yeah, not at E3. It's interesting. Thank you for bringing that up, Will. Brought that up before the podcast. I forgot it.
Good job, Will.
Thanks.
So you're talking
about... Your approval means everything.
Oh, good.
Good.
You're very approval driven. Yeah, like, please love me.
Please love me.
How are we doing on time, by the way?
Very short.
Very short?
10 minutes.
10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Cool. So I guess this was originally going to be a main thought, but we'll switch it over to just like a quick thought.
Was somebody asking about it or
what? No, no. It was an interesting story that I think we could have a take on. So I found it. So essentially, there is a guy who started a blog. His name is... Oh, God. Where is it? Yeah. His name
is Maxime Baudouin.
He wrote a blog post called "Why I Quit My Dream Job at Ubisoft," that went into it. Essentially, went really far into like the beginnings of how Ubisoft starts to work and kind of the backgrounds behind it. And essentially, he left the AAA industry because you get tunnel vision with, you know, when you get huge teams of like. I think in his blog post, he talked about having a 24-hour development where there'd be like three different companies working on it. So when one company would leave, another company, for when one company would go to bed, it'd be another company's morning. And they could just pick it up and keep going. And the main reason why he cited leaving is just because you get people who, you know, they work in the art department and their title is environmental art. And, you know, you get 10 people who really take that to heart, and then they just get tunnel vision, and all they care about is, like, the only thing that matters about this game is how good the environment looks, and that's where all the money should be devoted, and so there becomes, like, a lot of arguments and stuff from the AAA, and so he actually dropped out and created his own game, and now he's an indie developer, and just kind of enjoying life that way.
Has he announced what that game is?
He has, and that is going to be our indie spotlight of the day.
Whoa! Segway, open bar.
Look at that.
Oh, a mobile game, too.
I know, it's a mobile game. But it's called Open Bar. It's cool. I mean, it's just like a normal kind of bring it up on the big screen, because you can't really see that on the small.
I knew it was mobile, because that's an iPad.
Good job, Chris.
Look at that. But yeah, it's just a nice little, like...
It's a little puzzler.
Oh, I thought it was about, like, drinking.
You know, it goes into, like, drinking, but I don't get... Why?
Lovingly handcrafted.
It's all about drinking.
It's open bar.
So it's using a sort of thematic drinking, but the game itself has nothing to do with drinking?
That's my guess. It just looks like a normal puzzle game, where they're just like, it's a bar that's open, so let's call it Open Bar. Also, YouTube can do videos like this, which is kind of cool. I just liked the presentation on the website.
Whoa. Yeah, that is different.
That's a YouTube embed? Interesting.
Yeah, this is a YouTube
embed. When did they start doing that?
Look at that.
I'm looking at it.
Look at it.
Look at it.
Look at it. How does it look when you click onto YouTube? Oh, so they just embed it.
They just cut off the sides.
Yeah, embed and probably some CSS shenanigans.
Okay. Anyway, their site looks cool. So go check out Open Bar. It actually comes out today.
Oh, well, so there you go.
Tomorrow.
Today. Yeah. But this is when it comes up. So it comes out today.
You just can't let that thing go, can you? The idea that whatever we say has to be from the day that we're putting the podcast out.
Go download it now.
As if time has lost all meaning outside of release day.
Time has lost all the meaning. What is today? Who is time? Anyway, so I just thought it was kind of an interesting...
Who is time?
Who is time?
That's a good idea. We should write that down for a game name.
That's going to be the
name. We're copywriting that. Write it down right there. It's a copyright.
Verbal copyright.
Yep.
Damn it, hold on.
MVG. 2016.
As soon as you write something down or it's recorded, it's a copyright.
Verbal copyright.
You don't have to write verbal copyright.
I'm writing verbal copyright.
But you're writing it down, so it's not a verbal copyright.
Who is time?
It's a written copyright.
Fine.
Whatever. You do.
Verbal/written copyright.
Okay.
Who is time? Yeah.
Who is time? I don't know what they want to kind of...
I have no idea what that game would think of be, game, but...
I don't know.
Maybe that can be our... Global Game Jam game.
There you go.
Global Game Jam. What if that's
you guys don't know what the theme is yet, right? They announce it on the day that you start.
I don't know. Fuck them. I don't work for them.
They don't know me. They send out the theme early, but you're not supposed to talk about it.
And their themes are so open most of the time, you can fit anything in there.
Yeah, like last year's was What Do We Do Now?
Which is
Yeah. It's like, what do we do
but
now?
But it's super open-ended.
But it gave us our game.
Versus, like, Ludum Dare, where one of them was, like, unconventional weapon. That's, like, super specific.
Yeah.
And gives you a lot of, like, one area to work within.
That was the food fight game, right? The Smiling Cat did?
Yeah.
Duke from Smiling Cat was unconventional weapon.
Unconventional weapon.
That was a good one.
I saw somebody stream developing a game in real time during that Ludum Dare, and it was about you're a beekeeper shooting a bee gun at bears. Who are coming to take your honey. And like the bees would stay on the ground, so you had to go out and pick them up and then come back and keep shooting bears. Mm. It was really interesting.
I like the idea of game jams. Like you just get like these crazy games like that.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Pretty much I think all of Smiling Cat's games come from Ludum Dare's. And then he's just like, I really liked the idea, so I just stuck with it.
I think my brother and I are going to participate in a Ludum Dare at some point.
Cool. We will probably be hosting them here. So
yeah, let's do one.
Let's do it. Sweet. So I think we'll go ahead and start wrapping things up from there. Sound good?
What you playing?
I am playing Chrono Trigger because I platinumed Persona. Yay.
Yeah. I'm excited you're playing Chrono Trigger. I'm really curious.
Yeah.
About what you think. Like it's I feel like it might have the just like the right amount of like sort of Japanese-y for you since you're into Persona and stuff.
The right amount of Japanese-y.
Yeah.
I'm digging it so far. I have to admit I haven't really felt any Japanese-y yet.
I mean not like it's just the way well maybe
I don't know.
Not like culture wise, but just sort of the tradition of fantasy strategy games.
Oh, gotcha.
If that makes any sense.
Okay, so like the it's got the JRPG.
Yeah, yeah.
It's got the
hopefully no 30-hour tutorial.
No,
good.
It's a short game. It's 15-18 hours. Like,
yeah,
it's a very short game by have you ever, Square standards.
Have I ever played Chrono Trigger?
Yeah.
No.
There we go. Do you have a DS?
Michelle has a 3DS.
Okay.
That'll work, right?
When I'm done, I'll let you borrow it.
Cool. It's a good game.
Okay.
You mean when
is it available on the virtual console?
What do you mean? Like for
the Wii U?
The Wii U? Yeah. Or, do you guys have a Wii U?
My brother does, and I can easily borrow it from him.
I don't know.
I think it is. I'll look it up.
Wait, what am I talking about? I could probably emulate it on PC. What's wrong with me?
You certainly can.
Yeah.
I remember the music. Are the sound effects being a little weird on the PC, but I'm sure it's fine.
Oh, no.
Don't get it on.
Oh, no.
Do not get it on mobile.
Oh, no.
It's terrible on mobile.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I bought it for iOS.
Are you speaking from experience?
Yeah, it is not. It's just not very good.
Okay. Oh, no. Mobile, why?
Why? Square has been, I mean, just look at it, like $16 for those games?
Jesus.
Like,
yeah.
And they're really not that good, like.
And they're like crappy ports of those games.
Yeah, I mean it's okay, but it's just I don't know.
6, 5, 3.
Just hurts, man.
Original one, 5 again. Wait, why is 5 in there twice? It's not. I just don't know how to read 9.
There's 6, 4, 3.
6, 4, 3.
I haven't seen a 5. There's 5.
There's 5.
And Final Fantasy is that 1? Final Fantasy's Dimensions. I don't even know what that is.
I don't know.
Didn't you also say that they did like a really terrible port of like Mega Man X?
Oh, the Capcom Mega Man port is unbelievable. Oh,
I have seen that one. That's
unbelievable.
Awful.
Yeah, everything's like zoomed in and like the screen transitions are all wonky. Like, I mean, it destroys the way the game flows.
Yep.
Like, it just doesn't.
And Mega Man X is a fantastic game.
Yeah. Cool. So that's what you're playing?
Yeah.
Will, what are you playing?
Diablo 3.
What?
I got back into it with my brother.
Chris
it's really
down
good.
The hole for a while.
I did go down the Diablo 3 hole for
it
a
was,
while.
It was pretty crazy.
On PC or console?
PC.
Okay, yeah. When it started out, it wasn't super great. But
Mac.
Subsequent expansions
on
and...
Mac.
Oh, okay. Subsequent expansions and patches, and it's really good now.
Mm.
So,
have you guys played on consoles?
Diablo 3? I've heard it's pretty good with a controller.
Interesting. Yeah, I've...
Yeah, people say it's good.
I've never played a Diablo game. Just because I never played PC games growing up because I had really bad computers.
I think it's a little too late to get into Diablo 2, which arguably is the best Diablo.
I think we should totally play. We should do like a LAN Diablo 1 sometime.
Yeah. We could like, very easily.
And just like stream that.
We could very easily
stream. How many people? Is it a 4-player? Could we do a 4-player hookup on?
On Diablo 1?
Yeah.
I'd,
Or is, really? It only, or is it only two players? It's got to be four. Like, I feel like
I don't know. I know Diablo 2 was definitely four player.
Yeah. But that could be pretty fun.
That could be sweet. Fun.
If it's not four player yet, I'm sure there are mods.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I am playing. I just beat Uncharted 1.
Whoa,
I'm
going to
try to
Diablo.
Platinum that.
Get out of
here. And I am... I just beat Shovel Knight, and I was trying to platinum that, but I think I need to take a break. That game's pretty frustrating to try to platinum.
Shovel Knight?
Shovel Knight, yeah.
What do you have to do in order to platinum it? Like, what's your hang-up?
The hardest things are you have to beat the game, like, a bunch of times. You have to beat the game, then you have to beat the game on New Game Plus, then you have to beat the game in less than an hour and a half.
Jesus.
Then you have to beat the game without dying or falling into a pit. Then you have to beat the game without spending any money. And you can, like, combine these in ways, but, like, it's hard... Because it's like the hour and a half one, like, you don't want to combine that one with not spending any money.
Sure.
Because then you only have three hits. And just, yeah. And, oh, and there's one where you destroy every checkpoint. So on That's one a- of those playthroughs, you have to go through and make sure you never die in any of the levels, which you can combine with the never dying
one. Never die
one.
The game.
So that one's kind of fine. But you still have to never die. And there's one where you have to... I think there's you have to beat a level without taking any damage at all, which yeah. I thought I had done, and then I looked at the trophy and it wasn't there, so I don't know what had happened with that. But
yeah, Shovel Knight's a hard game to platinum, probably right up there with Super Meat Boy.
Yeah, so that's why
it's a good game though.
When you were talking about the like sort of point and click or adventure kind of games, I was like, I think that's what I'm in the mood for now. It's just something that I can take my time with and like doesn't require constant Twitch gameplay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, bearing that in mind, I would suggest either Life is Strange or Tales from the Borderlands.
Okay.
Or
I would actually suggest Tales from the Borderlands over Life is Strange.
Yeah. If you want to beat a game, I think Grim Fandango is still free.
Yeah, Grim Fandango I got, and then I might do Danganronpa.
Yeah, Danganronpa. I still don't know quite what that is. I've only made it through the prologue, and then I switched back to Persona. But I think...
I mean, on that, like, Persona Japanese, I'm watching the animation, like... Yeah. It might be fun to go back in the Japanese world and kind of do some stuff. I'll miss my Chia and Yukiko.
Chia?
Yosuke.
Chia. And the Can other we get peoples. A Chia?
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 Chia? Chia? Chia? Chia?
Chia? Chia? Chia? Chia? Chia?
I was watching videos about Persona 5 today.
Kanji bears.
I was watching videos about Persona 5 today, and there is a significant lack of social links inside the menu.
Oh, really?
And that scares the hell out of me, because that's why Persona 4 is so goddamn good.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. If they switch more towards the dungeons and less towards the... I like the dating sim aspects of that game more than anything
else.
Yeah,
that's by far the best part of those games.
I feel like the more you guys talk about Persona, the farther and farther I get away from figuring out what it's about.
Persona, okay, so Persona...
I think we should just leave it there. All right. I kind of like the idea of, like, just every time we talk about it...
I'm just more and more confused.
Yeah, we'll just kind of check back in with him and see where he's at about the whole thing.
How you feeling about it, Will?
I don't know. A little scared.
Sweet.
It was pretty great, though, because one of my last trophies I got for Persona 4 was reading all of the books. And when you read all of the books, it's like, you've read all of the books. You feel a little empty inside. And I was like, I'm about to beat Persona 4. I feel a little empty inside.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's been episode 70, I think, of WMVG.
That has been episode 70.
Seven decades of WMVG.
Hey, that was my joke.
I know.
I said that before the podcast.
Well, we're going to cut out that segment, so no one will ever know.
I'm grumpy now.
Hey, I'm grump.
70 episodes, so. You can find us on the iTunes at WMVG, so find us, like us, subscribe, all that fun stuff. You can find us on the internet at Multivarious Games. You can find us on Facebook at Multivarious Games. You can find us on Twitter at Multivarious. You can find me personally on Twitter at C_Volpe. You can find Will at Temperance101. And you can find Cody at Cody Was Here.
Yay!
You can also email us, just like Robert did, at WMVG@MultivariousGames.com. So ask us questions about whatever we've been talking about, or if you're interested in learning something about game development or our take on the games industry, or, you know, whatever.
Ask personal questions. Yeah. Like, what's that weird rash on Chris's back?
I have no idea. I've been trying to figure that out for like 2 months.
Yep.
I haven't gone to a doctor, but, you know, WebMDs.
Yeah, they're all quacks anyway.
Yeah, it's a bunch of scam artists.
Eat some ginseng root or something.
Sweet. Essential oils.
There you go.
Awesome. Well, thank you all for listening. We don't have a song this week, do we, Cody?
Nope. I mean, we could find a song. Chris, what's our song this week?
We're not gonna take it.
No, we're not gonna take it. We're not gonna take it anymore.
Da-na-na-na-na.
All right, we'll see y'all next week.
Bye.
Bye.